So this is, you know, kind of, we started with a look to the history. Now we're kind of looking to the moon and beyond. And MIT is a great place for moonshots. And I think the framing is really, you know, what if our wildest dreams become realities? What will that future of teaching and learning look like? You know, with, I think, a little bit of a positive spin on it, like the future we would like to live in, rather than the Black Mirror version of it. But we'll have great, you know, three short talks, and then we'll have a very short discussion. I won't do long introductions, just Professor Pattie Maes from the Media Lab leads the Fluid Interfaces Research Group. Also, Pattie and I collaborated a few years ago on an online course called Experiments in Generative AI, September 2021. You know, we were like, wow, we had to work really hard to get 100 people to show up for this course. A year later, we're like, wow, the world has changed. So I think, you know, the fact that you're always a year ahead of everyone else, I think is kind of...
Hopefully more than a year.
Well, yeah, hopefully more than a year. Hal Abelson is a professor in ECS and CSAIL, involved in a string of really amazing education-related things besides his research in computer science, recognized not just as a researcher, but really also an educator and someone who thinks very deeply about the role of technology. And then I've never had the pleasure of introducing someone where the title starts with Major, Megan Muniz, from the U.S. Air Force. She's the Chief Learning Officer at the AI Accelerator. So we're very excited to have these three speakers, and I'll hand it over to you, and then we'll have a short discussion at the end.
Thank you, Philipp. So the slides are a little bit washed out, but I think you'll get the idea nevertheless. I want to look a little bit further out to not just how generative AI is changing education today and how we should respond to that, but what new types of education and learning these technologies will make possible going forward. Now, the probably sort of ideal method, I would say, of learning and schooling and education is maybe still the Socratic method. The idea being that you basically have a thought-provoking dialogue between a teacher and just a few students. The teacher acts as a facilitator, compelling students to really think for themselves and come up with answers to questions for themselves, to think deeply, to be critical, to see different sides of an argument, etc., instead of the teacher, say, instructing and giving answers and facts, and the kids just sitting there quietly and absorbing it all, supposedly. Of course, this model, we can't, I wish we could implement it in reality and hire like the most wise people to be teachers and have very small groups and make it interactive. But in practice, our model is probably still very much influenced by the so-called factory model of schooling and education that was introduced in the US sort of around 1850, in Europe maybe earlier. And of course, that there were good reasons for sort of creating these classrooms with lots and lots of kids of the same age, sitting quietly without moving, listening to a teacher, give the same curriculum across different schools, etc. The benefit was that this could scale, was cheaper, that you had like known outcomes of what kids had to know or don't know at the end of the year. But of course, there's a lot of disadvantages to that model. And to be honest, schools today are probably somewhere in between these two extremes that I've presented, the Socratic method and then the factory model. But I would argue that they're not close enough to that ideal of the Socratic model as I wish it to be. So a lot of schools, of course, today are still, well, kids are grouped by ages, and there's a standardized curriculum and standardized tests at the end to see whether the kids know it, and everybody has to learn in the same way, etc. So I think this still results in a lot of kids being disillusioned, checking out, and not reaching their full potential because of the method that we are using. Now, I would argue, and this is the more provocative part of the talk, that with recent advances in AI, in machine learning, in sensors, in wearable devices, we can rethink education in a much more radical way than what we've been talking about so far this morning. We can basically aim, and this is a moonshot, so it's a 5 to 10 year plan, but we can aim to create a personal Socrates for every kid or every student. What this would consist of is some device that is with you all the time, that is more context aware, so it knows what you are dealing with. It may even know what you are talking about, thinking about, etc. And it can act as that Socrates, sort of as a mentor, as a motivator, as a thought provoker, encouraging you to see things differently, to go deeper, to and so on. Today's chat systems, one problem with them is that they basically, you ask a question and it gives you the answer, and as a result, people stop thinking, really, because it's too easy to just get the answer, copy and paste, and you never really engaged with the material yourself. But there's no reason why we can't use these same underlying technologies in a way where these systems ask you questions, smart questions, rather than giving you answers. That is totally possible. So I think we can basically almost today start experimenting with systems where, for example, a kid comes across, say, a weird plant, and it engages in a chat dialogue with a system that knows what that kid is looking at, that is appropriate to the level of knowledge of that kid, can bring in their interests, their way of learning, what they are especially passionate about, etc. So the kid can just ask, what's this weird plant? Oh, that's a pitcher plant. It can catch insects. Oh, how does it do it? Well, think, take a look at it. Take a look at what the shape is. What is the surface of that plant, etc. Encouraging the kid to think and discover and really become so much more engaged with the world around them. So I would argue that we can experiment with these systems today and that there is a huge potential upside. We can have a personalized tutor that customizes their entire instruction to the level of knowledge and the demonstrated proficiency of the student, the learning style that works for that student, the emotional state in the moment and of that student, the interests of that student. You can do anywhere, anytime learning, all day long, unlimited breadth and depth of material. The kid can go so much deeper into areas where they are passionate. The system can track the student's knowledge and proficiency and make sure to push them in other directions where they may have gaps in their knowledge. And I think this would democratize learning opportunities. However, I'm sure that a lot of the people in the room, maybe the MIT half, is like, oh yeah, this sounds exciting. I'll help you work on that. And maybe the educators and so on in the room are like, oh my God, are you, we have a problem with education today. Are you replacing sort of a better solution that involves good teachers, smaller schools, better instruction methods with technology, a technology band-aid sort of? And I agree, we have to be mindful of that. That is not what I'm going after. So there are challenges of like, how can this supplement human instruction or teaching of any sort, the parents, the teachers? How can we make sure that this doesn't result in the kid being isolated and only talking to its little Socrates about things rather than to peers and so on? But I think that all of these challenges are manageable, and if we keep them front and center, we can actually design solutions that can work and that can really overcome problems also such as privacy of data, who has the power over these systems and what they teach our kids. Is it the government, a corporation, is it the parents, etc.? These are all questions we should be asking upfront to design this technology to ultimately benefit our learning. Thank you.
green.
Yep.
Okay, so Patty, I'm glad you mentioned at the end the kind of danger of us at MIT going off on this jag of thinking we're saying something about education without thinking about the political reality of which this has to happen. Let's remember that Socrates, after all,
was murdered
for corrupting the youth of Athens. In any case, I was told this is a moonshot panel. I want to share with you my moonshot. And again, Patty talked about going farther out. I'm talking about going closer in. My moonshot is that this technology we are making becomes a tool for everyone, not just educated people, not just people who have a lot of technical background, and even kids in middle school and primary school, and not just about learning, about making things with meaningful social impact that can have an impact on improving their lives, on their families, and their communities. So the name for this particular moonshot is computational action. And it's not about we're training them so they can go work for industry in 5 years or 10 years or something. It's that even middle school kids can do things now. That's my moonshot. Let me give you an example. Dharavi is one of the largest slums in India. It has about 1 million people in it. The average family income is about $100 a month. Dharavi is also home to the Dharavi Girls for Change. And what the Girls for Change do is they make mobile apps aimed at improving the lives of the people around them. So they're a group of girls from about 12 to 16, the Girls for Change. And one of the things that they've made is a mobile app that schedules their families' time at the community water distribution plant. And this, of course, is directly relevant to their lives because they don't have to go there and don't have to fight and do these things. And of course, for the family, who's the family going to send to go stand in line and be in the fight? So this is immediately applicable to something that they can see in their lives. The name of the app is Pani, which means water. And Pani demonstrates computational action because it shows that even children in the poorest communities can create tools to improve lives of people around them. Not next year and not after they study and not after maybe they go to university and maybe they don't, but now they can see this technology as something that is directly relevant to their lives. Let me give you another example. Moldova was in the news a lot. You know that Moldova has a lot of problems from Russian aggression and Russian threats. Another problem Moldova has is a lot of hepatitis B. And one problem in Moldova is finding good water. And there's a group of about four high school girls in Moldova who've made an app called Apapura for good water. And what you do is you take your mobile phone and you find a source of water, you take a picture of it, you fill out a little questionnaire which has, is this good, what's it like, is it pure, is there other stuff like, oh, and this particular thing, the pump handle is broken, so you can't really use it. And that goes on to, in this case, they're using Google Maps, and you get a map that shows the sources of water. Okay? And so anybody who's driving around Moldova, or in fact anybody in the world who can see Google Maps, can see the source of water. So think of that. This is four high school girls who have created something that is a plausible national resource. That's something that can happen right now. And of course, there's the map. And again, this is computational action. because it says that even children right now can create valuable resources that have nationwide scope. So yes, it's about learning, and yes, it's all about the wonderful ideas that, you know, that all of us teach and we love to teach, but this is really about giving even children the power to do significant things just because of the wonderful technology and infrastructure that we've made that makes it accessible to everyone. As I said, the moon, this is a moonshot. The moon is, you know, getting in reach. We run this out of a server at CSAIL. We've been running it for 10 years. The all-time usage for this over the last 10 years is about 20 million users. We currently have a million active users a month. And over time, I think people have created about 80 million apps. But this is happening right now from MIT. The real democratization of app development. What's next? Well, what's next is, of course, this, like everything else, is getting revolutionized by generative AI. How do you take stuff that's already easy enough for middle school students to build stuff and make it even easier? Well, one of the things, you might have heard the expression due to Andre Karpathy, who's at OpenAI now and was one of the pioneers in machine learning, that the programming language of the future is English. What would it be like if you could just go to your machine or just listen to things around you and you could describe something that you wanted in English? And it just makes it for you, right? No sitting in a terminal, no moving programming things around. Just say in English what you want, and there it is. Well, that's what we're building right now in our research group at CSAIL. It's called Aptly, and it takes spoken descriptions. You don't have to type anything. It takes spoken descriptions of what you want, and it doesn't create programs from that. It creates the actual application that you want. So here someone says, make an app with some different buttons, and when I press a button, some buttons that correspond to languages, and when I press a button, translate what I say into that language and speak the result. Okay, and you say literally that, and out comes this actual application where you press a button and it translates what you've said into another language and speaks the result. And of course, you can edit it. You don't do a one shot. So in this case, you can say, in the languages you've chosen, remember the program chose the languages, but you can say, in the languages you've chosen, I don't see any Asian languages, add some Asian languages. And then the app that this wrote now gets modified to be how you change it. So just imagine, and it's not that far away, imagine that people could use this computer technology that easily. Say what you want, and you get it. And think about what that means. Again, not only for middle school kids, but think about what that means as empowering everyone to be using all of this stuff that's coming from generative AI. So it is not that far away. And in fact, I know some of you have already seen the demo in the other room, and I encourage you, the other ones, to do it. You can go and actually try this and see what's there now. Okay? So that's all I have to say. I encourage you to look at the demo, but I want you to really think about, we don't have to think about 5 years out or 10 years out. The pace at which this technology is evolving is truly amazing, and it's going to open up things, gosh, in the next months. So let me leave you with that. Take a look at the demo if you get a chance, but really, really be ambitious in terms of what can happen. Thank you. Okay.
Good morning, everybody. Megan Muniz, Major Megan Muniz. So I am a U.S. Air Force officer. We have a small unit here with MIT. It's a cooperative agreement where we are, there's 12 of us. We're a tiny unit. We are pushing research, artificial intelligence research, in the direction we accelerate of the Air Force's interests, needs. What I do as a chief learning officer is I work with Cynthia. We have an education research project. And why do we have education research? Because it's an MIT hard problem when you think about what the DAF, Department of the Air Force, looks like. So you don't need to read all of this, but you can see the vast structure, right? And not only do we have the Air Force, but also the Space Force. So there's major commands, the structure is there's major commands and everything trickles down. But we need to think about all of those different commands have different missions, right? So one is education and training. One is air combat command. Think about materiel command. So all these different commands with people in them who are thinking about different missions, and we need to teach them different skills. Now AI is one of those. So my moonshot is how do we use generative AI to upskill the Department of the Air Force? So we're a very broad ecosystem. When you think about how hard this problem is, we have over 200 AFSEs. And if you didn't know, the Air Force loves acronyms. So AFSC is Air Force Specialty Codes. So different jobs in the Air Force. 200 different people with different career fields, all with the same mission. How do we upskill them in different ways using generative AI? We have different ranks, right? We have officers, we have enlisted, we have barely enlisted to 30 years of service. How do we service those people? Different operational experiences. We have pilots, we have data scientists, we have logisticians, we have people in whatever you can think of, we have it, right? And not to mention we're worldwide. We have 80 plus bases worldwide. So if we think about the demographics of that, we have different ages, right? We have a different percentage of men and women who might learn differently. We have different ethnicities and races. And yes, all of these pictures were generated with Dolly. We also have different educational backgrounds, right? The officers, to be an officer, you need to have at least a bachelor's degree or higher. And you can see the different percentages there. And this is just active duty, right? We have reserves, we have civilians, we have cadets at the different service academies. And then you can see the enlisted educations there, but that might be a different audience in terms of how we can use these technologies to upskill based on their baseline knowledge level. So when we think about this, these are just different topics, and we've actually heard about a lot of these today. But when we think about upskilling a workforce, we've heard a lot about personalization and adaptability, but those come with challenges in the Air Force because things are harder with government, right? Especially with our networks and the different platforms that we can use. So if we think about immersive learning environments, there's a project called Pilot Training Next, where they have started transitioning, taking pilot trainees out of the cockpit, because that's very expensive, into simulators, right? But those simulators are built by different companies with deterministic scenarios. Can we use generative AI to now enhance our training in simulators? That will be better for pilots, right? And so when you think about the question I get all the time, oh, you're in the Air Force, you must fly. No, I don't fly, but there's different, we can all have different learning environments, right? Based on our different jobs. So that's, I think those are places where generative AI can help us. When we think about scalability and accessibility, one thing that is very hard, one of the takeaways that we've learned from our projects is there's a lot of learning MOOCs out there, there's a lot of different tools out there, but they cannot go on our networks. So we have a huge challenge with getting learning onto our platforms. One thing that we're excited about is we were able to get MIT Horizon onto one of our systems. So that's great. That's something that's come out of MIT in partnership with us in order to upskill the Department of the Air Force. We're really excited about it. And that kind of gets to, so we have a platform called Digital University. It kind of gets to this continuous learning culture. Can I get every single airman and guardian onto that platform to learn the baselines of artificial intelligence and the different technologies that are on things like MIT Horizon? It's very challenging though, right? Because we all have day jobs. We don't, unfortunately, as much as I would love to, we don't get to sit there and learn all day. We have to go about our jobs. So how can we leverage generative AI into our jobs and cultivate that continuous learning culture? And finally, something that's very hard in the Department of Defense is of course, there's ethical considerations. Not just the problems that we're thinking about and the nature of our jobs, right? But our data, we can't share our data. I cannot use ChatGPT with any of our Air Force data. We're working to get something like that onto our systems. But I guarantee you there are airmen out there who have done that, right? And it's a problem though, right? Like we don't want that, but how can we get the technology into our hands in a safe way and know that our data is safe? And then the final consideration is human AI collaboration, and not just in the sense of how we think about teaching and learning and interacting with a bot, but the nature of what we do, right, is we might be fighting alongside a artificially intelligent agent. So how do we teach people? How can we leverage generative AI to teach people to do that and trust agents that they might literally be fighting alongside? So the moonshot is, we need to upskill a whole Department of Defense in a technology as challenging, but also as useful, and leverage it in a way that's safe and responsible for our national security. And that's all that I had.
Great. Thank you so much. Also, I realize, for a moonshot panel, someone from the Space Force is an obvious obvious link here. I want to maybe just pick up one thread here and have all of you respond to that. And it's prompted by Hal's presentation, maybe more than the others, but it connects to the others, which is this question of access and equity. And I think it's a complicated question, because even in your example, if English becomes the programming language of the future, the people who are providing the service that then creates those apps all of a sudden become incredibly powerful. And we, throughout the day today, we've used the term ChatGPT as if it was a public service, as if we all were going to have access to it forever. And MIT has this history of open source. And so your example then connected to this in a way where you're actually not allowed to use these tools in your environment. It's a different context, but there's also reason. And you know, you had the Socrates example where power responds to these changes. So I just wonder if you can maybe reflect a little bit. If we want to make sure that both there's public access to this technology so that everyone has opportunities to learn and teach, and also what are some of these implications of having these large technology companies in the mix? Maybe we'll start with you, Hal.
Okay, well, a couple of things to comment on. First of all, the use of English and the idea that everybody's going to be doing things in English, which of course is unfair and of course can't be true. At some levels, the technology can handle it. You can actually go to the demo, I think, and describe what you want right now in another language, I think like Italian or something. The generative AI stuff is powerful enough to just, as a matter of course, do a translation. But that's not really what you're asking. The real issue is about equity. It's one of the reasons why we think about doing stuff on mobile phones. I mentioned our server at MIT. About half of those users are from developing countries. It's not good enough, and it's still too expensive. And it's something we really, really, really have to work on. One of the other things that we're doing that MIT RAISE is coordinating is a policy paper about various what should happen to various levels of government. And the idea of simply the expense of this stuff is enormous. It's easy to say from MIT, but one of our recommendations is for really governments have to think about this, because the more this gets used, the more risk there is of real inequality and a real difference between the developed world and the developing world. So it's a very, very important question.
Yeah, I think one of the problems with all of this technology is that these days it is pretty much only private companies, corporations that can afford to build these models, train these models, make them available. And some of them are making things more open than others, but it's frustrating, I think, and that they ultimately control the technology, can change it on a whim. In fact, these systems do change from time to time, and everybody's applications are messed up as a result. So yeah, I think that is a big concern, that it's, I mean, only a few big players that can do this. Yeah.
I think, so for the Department of Defense, because only a few players can do it, we cannot do it on our own, right? We don't have the compute, we don't have the people to be able to build something like ChatGPT, right? So what we think about is, one, there needs to be some sort of policy, and Biden's executive order on AI is something that we fall under, right? And we think about a lot, but then that trickles down and every commander is thinking about how do we regulate this and how do we incorporate it? And I don't really have an answer. I have all the same questions, but it is a difficult and important question.
Okay. Well, maybe I'll close with just a reflection. You know, if I think historically, when there was the moonshot, you know, the US decided that this was gonna be a major priority, and it committed resources and it brought together the minds that were required and the funding to really do something fundamental that has had positive impact on STEM and many other fields for the decades since then. And I do think it's worth asking, you know, MIT is a place where a lot of the researchers who actually came up with the foundational ideas that were now being seen in these applications, you know, when the U.S. Air Force says we're not big enough to build these things, like, well, who is, you know, I mean, that slide was kind of, I'm still dizzy from seeing how big you are. So I just think maybe it's a moment to ask, like, how could institutions like MIT, the U.S. Air Force, you know, the governments work together to make sure that this technology is accessible to all. Anyway, I want to thank you, and this was fantastic, and hand it back to Chris.